Good evening and welcome to another hour filled with music and song from Ireland and from right here in Chicago. My name is Tom Looney with my co-host Siobahn of Bhuachalla. Welcome to the show, Siobahn.
Thanks, Tom. It's good to be back again. And coming up on tonight's show, we have lots of good music from the Fury Brothers and Davey Arthur, from the Dublin City Ramblers. Yes, this caliber keeps getting higher and higher. We've got the Celtic Aires, we've got lots more, and we have a very special feature on the makings of a very interesting instrument, the traditional Irish uilleann pipes. Tom.
Yes, and coming up now we have the Fury Brothers that most of you know, and what an entertainment group. I'm a little bit prejudiced probably on this one because their mother comes from Kilfenora in the County Clare, which is where my hometown is.
This song is all about a young lad who left home back in the 50s and he went to England to work on the dams in England, and while he was there they broke his back. So he came back to his native town or his native village and he got the nickname of Crooked Jack. It's a very angry song and a very great song. We'd like to do this, especially for all the paddies here tonight. Here we go. Word in there.
I'm an Irishman, I wrote the young man's dead, but I'm very sad in my Irish land. There are two ways, this many a day, than working from down the hole. I was home to all of 612, but they broke me across the back. By a day my nose and a sweet at my own, they called me for a great job. I cursed the day and I went on my way to work up the high-road Mars when I'm not here, my home's not cheers, I'm not being a shivering bit. I was calling to all the 612, they broke me across the land. Why you pay my loneliness, not my own, they call me for a bitch. I was home to all of 612, and they broke me across the land. I had made my loneliness not my own, they called me for a bitch. Now they say that I'm this kind of man, but his beard is not his soul. But believe me, guys, it's your sweat and blood when you're working down that hole. I was falling to all of 612, and they broke me across the time. I have made my own, but it's not my own. They called me for a picture. I have seen the gold before a time. The faces glide and gray. My heart talks so soon what mine, he lied in the self same way. I was falling to all of 612, and they broke me across the land. I have made my own, and it's not my own. They called me for a pigeon. So Irishman, hope you understand, but I've been shot in your soul. There are two ways to spend your days, and working down that hole. I was found to all the 612, and they broke me across the land.
Thank you.
Well, thanks to the Furies for that nice number, and they will be on later on the show. Now, here's a group that you have heard before on the show. That's the Celtic Aires with Martin Hayes and Paul McHugh. Martin has been a three-time champion fiddle player in Ireland, and now with his partner Paul McHugh, we have the Celtic Aires and the Mason's Apron.
It's a tune we're going to do two versions of. The first version is the more modern version of it. See if we can get you to join in, clap your hands, stamp your feet. I'm going to start it off with Martin. Then we're going to do the second, more older, traditional version of the tune. So we hope you enjoy our own little version here of a tune called The Mason's Apron.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed.
Welcome back again. Well, one of the most popular and quoted lines of anything W.B. Yeats ever wrote is, of course, his famous line, "I will arise now and go to the Lake Isle of Inishfree." Here now are the Dublin City Ramblers singing their version of that song, "The Lake Isle of Inishfree."
This song is one of my favourite songs. We have on one of our albums, I'm not sure which, but it's a song which I got from the one of my favourite films. I'm mad on old films. And there was a song, a film called The Quiet Man, who starred John Wayne, excuse me, Maureen O'Hara.
The horse.
The horse. But the music that was played through that lovely film was written into lyrics after, and it was called "The Lake Isle of Inishfree." So this is one of my favourite songs, and I'm going to sing it now. And if you know it well, you're very welcome to join in and sing along with us. So here we go. And Inishfree is, to me, is Ireland, by the way. I know it's a little spot off the coast of Sligo, heading for Donegal. I've met some folks who say that I'm a dreamer. I've no doubt there's truth in what they say. But your body's bound to be a dreamer. But all it takes, he loves are far away. Precious things are dreams unto an exile. They take him o'er the land across the sea. Especially when it happens he's in exile from that dear lovely isle of Inishfree. When the moonlight peeps across the rooftops of this great city, wondrous though it be, scarcely feel its wonder or its laughter. I'm once again back home in Inishfree. Take it away, Paul. Come on, woo! I've wandered over hills to dreamy valleys and find the peace no other land could know. I hear the birds make music fit for angels and watch the rivers laughing as they flow. But dreams don't last, no, dreams are not forgotten. Soon I'm part Eastern reality. Although they paved the footways here with gold dust, I still would choose my Isle of Inishfree. I still would choose my Isle of Inishfree. All right, thank you. That's one of my favorite songs.
You're watching Irish Television Chicago. Still to come, we have sports and a special feature this evening. And also we have a new face in the sports desk this evening. That's Tim Kelly. And now for the news, Siobhan.
For the news, we're going over to Mike Schevlin, who's going to tell us about a hodgepodge of events in Ireland. The Soviet Union has spoken out on human rights in the north of Ireland. There's more on the rod angling dispute. There's more on the controversy over constituency reforms over there. And in local Irish Chicago news, they've announced who's been invited to be Grand Marshal of the St. Patrick's Day Parade in 1989. That's all coming up with Mike Schevlin at the news desk.
Good evening. The Soviet Union has criticized the British government for what it calls massive violations of human rights in the north of Ireland. Mr. Gennady Gerasimov of the Soviet Foreign Ministry delivered the statement at a press conference in Moscow last Friday. The statement called on the British government to honor the final act of the Helsinki Agreement by releasing political prisoners and restoring legality and constitutional law and order in Ulster. Mr. Gerasimov stressed that this was not intended as an interference in the internal affairs of the United Kingdom, but he added the Soviet public had serious doubts about the fairness of the sentences passed in Ulster, the methods of investigation, and the conditions in which prisoners were kept. The British government has not yet commented on the Moscow press conference. However, it is known that human rights in the context of Northern Ireland was discussed by Mrs. Thatcher and Mr. Gorbachev when they met on the British Prime Minister's visit to the Soviet Union last year. The world-famous Dún an Uair Hotel in West Kerry is to be sold. Uldris na Gaeltachta, which owns the hotel and the adjoining chalets, began advertising for tenders for the property last weekend. The unique hotel, which is situated in the all-Gaelic-speaking area of West Kerry, known as Gorca Gina, offers traditional vacations based on the rich heritage of the region. The attached chalets are all built in an authentic Irish style, and the area itself is steeped in an historic tradition which boasts many links with the U.S. However, a substantial fall in the tourist trade over the past few years and rising maintenance costs have spelled hard times for Dún an Uair, which originally translated as the Fort of Gold. Uldris na Gaeltachta said that last Friday that it will be accepting bids for the entire complex or for separate units. In a report that met with immediate opposition, the Constituency Commission last week proposed extensive changes in the Galway electoral area, in what some Western newspapers termed a remarkable carve-up. The Commission called for whole areas of the county just north of Tuam to be transplanted into a new Mayo Galway three-seater constituency, while all of South Galway from Oranmore to Gort would become part of a new East Galway. This move would result in some unlucky Dáil deputies losing vast parts of their own constituencies. As objections are voiced, there is a growing feeling that the proposal may not make it to the floor of the Dáil. And still in the West, a dispute between anglers and the ministry that has cost Galway and Mayo millions in lost tourism revenue has prompted 21 parish priests and curates from the area to call for a compromise. Towns and small businesses are facing financial ruin due to a year-long ban on angling. In a letter to Fisheries Minister Brendan Daly, the priest stated, "Hostility has been created where it did not exist 12 months ago. Goodwill has been destroyed. The clear and single cause is the new rod license." Speculation is growing that Chicago's St. Patrick's Day Parade will be led by outgoing President Ronald Reagan in 1989. Chairman of the Parade Committee Jim McCarthy announced last Wednesday that he had invited President Reagan to serve as Grand Marshal on March 17, 1989, and he said the word from the White House was that it looks good. The President, whose family hailed from Ballyporeen, has also been invited to the Irish Fellowship dinner on St. Patrick's Night. The Irish Fellowship had played host to no less than four other U.S. presidents. William H. Taft, Harry Truman, Richard Nixon, and John F. Kennedy have all been guests at the annual March 17th dinner. Ireland has become well known for providing the world with top musical entertainment over the past few years, and one of the most enjoyable feedbacks of the Irish music phenomena is the huge increase in international artists visiting the country. A variety of performers ranging from Bob Dylan and B.B. King to the acclaimed Russian pianist Nikolai Demidenko have played to Irish audiences in recent years. But this weekend saw the return of one of the most popular artists ever to grace an Irish stage, Johnny Cash. The Man in Black played two nights in Dublin's Olympia Theatre and one in the Neptune Stadium in Cork. All shows were sold out well in advance, and most people clamoring to buy last-minute tickets from the touts outside the venues were disappointed. Johnny Cash and family treated their audiences to a host of new songs and old favorites, but all reports agree that the most rousing reception each evening was for Mr. Cash's lonely rendition of the song that made him a household name in Ireland. As he told a captive audience, it was good to be back in the land of the 40 Shades of Green. That's our news for this week. I'm Mike Schevlin. Have a good holiday.
Tomorrow is the 25th anniversary of the death of President John Fitzgerald Kennedy. His great-grandfather Patrick left his home in New Ross, County Wexford in 1850 during the famine years and settled in East Boston. Patrick's son, Patrick J. Kennedy, became very successful in the liquor business and entered the arena of the Boston politics, and was very pleased when his son Joe married Rose, the daughter of another Irishman and Boston politician, John F. Fitzgerald. Rose's second son John became the 35th president of the United States of America and the most loved leader in the 20th century. He won the hearts of the Irish people when he visited his great-grandfather's homestead in New Ross in 1963. 25 years later, in Ireland and in America, we still miss him.
Good evening and welcome to Irish Television Sports. And the big story in Irish sports this week is soccer. The Republic of Ireland squad traveled to Seville, Spain last weekend for their World Cup qualifying tie with the Spanish national side. Hopes that the Irish team might continue with the impressive standard of football displayed in the European Championships this summer were dashed when two more of the regular team had to withdraw because of injury. Star forward Ronnie Whelan and David Kelly were both injured in their league games over the weekend, and the earlier defections of Kevin Sheedy and Chris Houghton left manager Jack Carlton with the problem of trying to put a fit and able team together with just 2 days left before the World Cup tie. The most remarkable outcome of this dilemma was the recall of Arsenal defender David O'Leary. O'Leary has not played for the Irish international squad for over 2 years, but told reporters he was delighted to be back on the panel again. Hull City's Ken LeMange and West Ham midfielder Liam Brady were also last-minute call-ups. The depleted Irish side played well, particularly in the first half of the game, but the Spanish opposition were easily the better side of the night. They excelled in midfield and put up a tight defense against an Irish team that just couldn't score on the day. The final score of Spain 2-0 was an accurate reflection of the night's play. Praise must go to Spain's Emilio Butrango, who scored the winning goal for his side. Jack Charlton spoke to reporters after the game. He told them he was disappointed with the Irish performance, but it was a side hampered by injury and unused to playing together as a team. In hurling, both Galway and Dublin continue their winning streaks. Galway played at home to Kilkenny at Pierce Stadium, Sald Hill. In an outstanding first half, the Galway hurlers built up a decisive lead, which left Kilkenny struggling to catch up in a second half rally. Anna Ryan and Martin Naughton built up the scores for Galway, but star player for the Western team was Joe Cooney, who scored both of the Galway goals. The final score at Pierce Stadium was Galway 2-14 to Kilkenny's 1-11. In other National League games, Tipperary beat Wexford by an overwhelming 2-20 to 1-4. That's 26-7. Dublin beat Leinster rivals Meath by a 3-goal lead, and Cork looks set for promotion with an 8-point win over Clare at Cusack Park. Here's a rundown of all of last week's National League hurling scores. Galway beat Kilkenny 2-14 to Kilkenny's 1-11. Tipperary's 2-20 to Wexford's 1-4. Offaly's 2-18 to Limerick's 1-15. Waterford's 3-14 to Antrim's 2-10. Dublin's 4-7 to Meath's 1 goal and 7 points. Cork's 4 goals and 9 points to Clare's 2 goals and 7 points. And finally, Leash's 2 goals and 12 points to Westmeath's 2 goals and 6 points. And finally, some Irish sports news with a difference. American football packed the stands at Lansdowne Road last Saturday as Boston College took on the Army team from Westport Military Academy. An estimated 10,000 Americans traveled to Ireland to attend this important league game. The Emerald Isle Classic is the first of its kind to be played in Ireland, but this inaugural event has generated such an interest that the organizers say they are planning to make it an annual affair. That's our sports for the week, and I'm Tim Kelly.
Well, thanks to the news and sports team for that report. And as promised, we have the Fury brothers again and Davey Arthur. And this time it's about the old man, a traveling musician that traveled all around Ireland, but especially he was around Clare and specifically in Doolin in County Clare, that a lot of my neighbors and people knew him from playing around there. And this song is about the father, and it's called The Old Man, with the Fury brothers and Davey Arthur.
And now this next song is a song called The Old Man. Especially for Sheila, it says down here, okay. And the song was written as a tribute to her father, Ted. He died in Clare, Doolin, there a few years back. And very, very fond of Clare he was. I don't know, people often ask us what was he like when we were growing up, you know. And father was a very mysterious fella. He never, you know, we never called him father or pop or dad or anything like that. We always knew him as Ted since we were tiny kids, you know. And you know, you could tell him your most inner secrets, and he was great, great. He used to say one thing which I always remember him for, and I teach my own kids it now, you know, is if you're going to do it, feel it, he'd say. Never do it without feeling it. If you're going to do it, feel it. And then he says you get a great lift out of it, that you've done that because you've given something back into it. Anyway, this song, The Old Man, I'll sing it for you. Here we go. Thank you for Sheila there. Shh. Oh, he's down at the bar, it'd be great. The tears have all been shed now. We've said our last goodbye. His soul's been blessed and he's laid to rest. It's now I feel alone. He was more than just a father, a teacher, my best friend. He can still be heard in the tunes we shared when we played them on our own. Oh, we never will forget him, but he may be what I am. Though he may be gone, memories linger on. I miss him, my old man. As a boy, he'd take me walking, climb mountain, field and stream. He'd show me things not known to kings, and secret between him and me. Like the colours of the pheasant, as he rises in the dawn. And how to fish and make a wish beside a holy tree. Though I never will forgive him, but he made me what I am. Though he may be gone, memories linger on. he'd live forever.
He seemed
so big and strong.
To the minutes
flying, and the years rolled by for a father on the song. And suddenly, oh, when it happened,
there was so much
left unsaid.
No second chance
to tell him thanks for everything he's done. No, he never will forget him, but he may be what he has. Though he may be gone, he's still. God, I miss him, the old man. You're back there. What's up? Hey.
That was a beautiful, moving number from the Fury Brothers and Davey Arthur, and we, of course, will have more from them in the coming weeks. Well, now it's time for a feature, which is more in instrument making. This week, it's on one of the most unique instruments to Ireland, the uilleann pipes, which isn't just, by ordinary standards, a difficult instrument to play. Everything is difficult for me to play. But it's very difficult even for talented musicians because of the coordination that's involved between moving your elbow and your hands. It's sort of like that patting your head and rubbing your stomach at the same time thing. And we want to give a very special thanks to Benny Cochrane in Ireland, who sent us this feature.
Pipes of some description have existed in Ireland since pre-Christian times, but the uilleann pipes, which we know today, would seem to date from the late 17th century, when a bellows was first employed to inflate the bag. Schoolhouse near Downpatrick, Robbie Hughes shows that the uilleann pipes are alive and well. Robbie's first interest in pipe making came from the Belfast maker Frank McFadden, from whom he bought his first set. Frank McFadden, like many other pipe makers, was continuing a family business started by his father, and indeed Frank's grandson is playing pipes today. Robbie has been making pipes for over 10 years, and samples of his work are to be found all over the world. All the work in his pipes is done by hand, and the raw materials come from many varied places. The hardwood used in the chanter and drones comes from Mozambique. The cane for the reeds comes from Spain. The ivory mounts come from Tanzania. The leather used in the bag is native, as is the wood sometimes used in making drone reeds. The uilleann pipes are the most complex member of the bagpipe family, and possibly the only bagpipe to play in two octaves. The war pipes, for example, play in nine notes, most of which bear little resemblance to the accepted European scale. The uilleann pipe scale is much closer to the European tradition, with only one note varying from the standard scale. The facility to produce a second octave comes from the reed, which is somewhat like an oboe reed, and gives a higher octave when overblown. The reed is therefore a very important part of the setup, and the tolerances are very small. A good reed makes good pipes.
And cut it across where it's strongest. Where you, the V prevent cracks running out of it. And so you have the two halves of the reed. At this stage, you can again go back, and if there's any discrepancy along the sides, you can get rid of them by moving each side on the sandpaper. Get absolute evenness. And the next stage is to lash the two parts of the reed blades together using a piece of waxed hemp thread. This is thermal wax. It's important not to go above that 1-inch mark, because if you do, chances are that the blades of the reed may not close together properly, tightly, and the whole reed must be completely airtight. If there's any leakage of air into a reed, it will not function properly. Next, it's important to remove part of the sharp edge here, because this is the part where the hemp is going to be wrapped around, and we want the sides to be chamfered. Then we can fit the staple inside. Now, this is an important part of the operation, because if the staple is pushed too far into the cane head, it'll mean the second octave will be sharp. If it's not far enough in, then the second octave will be flat. So a good average is just over about 3/8 of an inch.
The final task for Robbie is to tune the pipes. This is done using modern technology. The chanter, or flute part, as well as the wooden parts, are turned on a lathe. This is a skilled part of the operation, as it affects not only the sound of the instrument, but also the cosmetic appearance as well.
We've got to keep the drill clear as we move up through it.
The chanter is the melodic part and consists of two parts, the whole part made of wood and the top part made of brass. There are 7 holes on the front of the chanter and 1 at the back. The reed is inserted into the wooden part. The air supply to the reed comes from a bag held under the left arm, and this in turn is supplied by a bellows operated by the right arm. Inserted into the lower part of the bag is a cylindrical piece of wood, which contains firstly the drones.
The baritone drone.
The 3 drones are each pitched in a different octave of D.
The bass regulator.
Unique to the uilleann pipes are the regulators. These are also situated on the lower side of the bag, and like the drones, are arranged as bass, tenor, and treble. They're simply keyed chanters, stopped at the end, and which sound when the keys are pressed either by the wrist, the heel of the hand, or the fingertips. The regulators usually sound a total of 13 notes.
And the tenor regulator.
Pipe makers can often be identified by their touch of artistry in the turning of the wooden parts, by the design of the metal or ivory work, or by the particular ways they mark their keys. Robbie Hughes, like his predecessors, combined all the pipe maker's crafts, plus the most important raw material, a genuine love and respect for a truly great traditional instrument.
Well, it's fascinating to watch an instrument like this being made. A lot more to it than most of us realize, Siobhan.
Tom, it is, and it's incredible to watch the tiny little details that the families have that have been handed down in generations, little secrets of the craft. Just watching it taking shape before us was fascinating, really, is the only word you can use. After the break, Bridge Looney will be joining us. She'll be giving us the calendar of events from the Irish American Heritage Centre, and we'll have lots more music, so do stay with us.
Good evening. I'm Bridge Looney, and now I would like to share with you the upcoming events at the Irish American Heritage Centre. Remember, if you have a need for a hall or a room for a party or that very special celebration, do call us here at the Irish American Heritage Centre, and I guarantee you we'll do everything we can to accommodate your needs. The prices are reasonable here, and there's ample parking right outside the door. For more information on the Irish American Heritage Centre, call 282-7035. Why not stop in at the centre sometime and have a chat with us and see what we're all about? That's the Irish American Heritage Centre, 4626 North Knox Avenue. And the phone number there is 282-7035.
Well, a very busy calendar of events at the Irish American Heritage Centre, and hopefully we'll be bringing you many of those events right here on Irish Television Chicago. Now, here is Bertella and the Wild Rover.
I've been a wild rover for many's the year, and I've spent all my money on whiskey and beer. But now I'm returning with gold in great store, and I never will play the wild rover no more. And it's no, nay, never, no, nay, never, no more will I play the wild rover. No, never, no more. I went into an alehouse I used to frequent, and I told the landlady my money was spent. I asked her for credit, she answered me nay. Such a custom as yours I can have any day. And it's no, nay, never, no, nay, never, no more will I play the wild rover. No, never, no more. Well, I pulled from my pocket 10 sovereigns bright, and the landlady's eyes opened wide with delight. She says, I have whiskey and wines of the best, and the words that I told you were only in jest. And it's no, nay, never, no, nay, never, no more will I play the wild rover. No, never, no more. It's no, nay, never, no, nay, never, no more will I play the wild rover. No, never, no more. I'll go home to my parents, confess what I've done, and I'll ask them to pardon their prodigal son. And when they've crossed me as oft times before, sure I never will play the wild rover no more. And it's no, nay, never, no, nay, never, no more will I play the wild rover. No, never, no more.
Once more.
And it's no, nay, never, no, nay, never, no more will I play the wild rover. No, never, no more.
Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed, the wild rover.
That was Nolan Audrey from Bertella. They hail from Limerick and Cork respectively, singing one of the most extremely popular songs ever requested from an Irish ballad, The Wild Rover. Tom.
Yes, if you have any comments on the show, please write to us here at Abbey Productions. That's 3825 North Elston Avenue, Chicago 60618. Or phone us at 539-6000.
Thanks to everybody who's written in, and keep the letters coming. We are making note of your comments. Join us next week when we'll have concert footage from the Wolf Tones at the Irish American Heritage Centre and lots more. Till then.
And leaving you tonight, we have the Dublin City Ramblers and a song written by Thomas Davis. And this is a number that I've heard since I was a small kid back in Ireland in school. And that's A Nation Once Again. And this is the Dublin City Ramblers. Until next week then, thank you for tuning in, and we'll see you next week.
Tear Slán.
Good night.
Well, I'll tell you what, we won't be doing a round of the inners. We'll sing a verse and a chorus of a song. There are people here, quite a lot of people here from Ireland. Most of the people in the audience are Ireland, our Irish generation now. But there's people here from various north, south, east and west. So we're going to sing a verse and a chorus of a song that, please God, is on the cards, I hope, one of these days. I hope, and I say it will be. It's a song about a united Ireland anyway, and it's called A Nation Once Again, so we're here.
A nation once again.
Everybody singing.
A nation once again. An Ireland long before its been. A nation once again. When I had fire, it was in my blood. I read of ancient freedom. Of Greece, of Rome, we bravely stood. 300 men and 3 men. Then I prayed I yet might see her fetters rent its way. An Ireland long,
come on,
a province be, a nation once again. 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 Slow down a bit now. An Ireland long, a province.
Good night, thank you.
A nation once again.
God bless, enjoy yourselves. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.